manger laid, Jesus, Lord of heaven and earth. Mary, Joseph, manger laid, with us sing our Savior's birth. Me and my drum. treasure of heaven, brilliant like the stars in the wintry sky. Joy of the Father, reach through the darkness, shine across the earth, send the shadows to fly. Close to you. Thank you for the gift of Jesus, our Emmanuel. Forgive us for forgetting that your love never changes, it never fades, and that you never abandon the purpose for which you came, to save us for our sinful nature and give us eternal life. Your birth and death sealed your promise to us forever. In Jesus' name,
amen, friends. Amen. Can we give God glory for our worship team this morning? Praise be to God. Thank you, team. We appreciate you guys. And before you're seated, it's like 6 days away, right? So there is a traditional greeting from the Jewish culture of ancient Israel, and they would say Maranatha. And Maranatha is a greeting that says, Christ is coming soon. Now that talks about Christ's second coming. We're living in Christ's first coming, but we're going to tie that together in the sermon. So all that to be said, before you're seated, would you greet somebody with the greeting and look at them in the eye and say, Maranatha. And I believe there's somebody here today that needs a handshake, that could use a hug or a high five. So let's be the one to give it to them with a Maranatha.
Well, good morning, church. Can I tell you how nice it is to be here and have to weave through all of the team we get to have up here on stage again? It's just crazy, you know, to think back just not that many months ago when there were only a few able to be up here. Now we have to jump wires and microphones, and what an awesome place to be at. It's so good to be with you here this Sunday morning. We hope you are ready to celebrate a Merry Christmas this week with the people you love. And we want to wish you a Merry Christmas here from the people who love you. We want to let you know if you are visiting, we are so thankful you're here. We have lots of ways that we can get to know each other better. One of them is the connection card you find in your bulletin. It's just a really quick way that we all sign in each day that we come to church and say we were here and we celebrated together. And it's also a way that we as a church know who was here so that we can serve you better. There's an opportunity for you to mark things that have interest to you so that we can get in touch with you and help you get better connected to God and to each other. And we're going to talk today about a few of the things that are coming up. Christmas Eve, obviously, is right around the corner. We have our 5 o'clock service. We hope that you'll come be here in person with us, but if you need to join us via live stream, you can certainly do that as well. We also have a community dinner at 6 o'clock right here in the church. It's a wonderful meal, and we encourage you to come and bring people with you for a wonderful time together. We also have our 11 o'clock candlelight service. We hope you can make it out for that one as well. Do you want me to move, Greg? Well, it can't go. Okay, so I have a big mouth. I'm sorry, guys. RP Family Christmas Pageant is tonight at 6 p.m. We got to be here for practice yesterday. It's so exciting because, you know, all the littles are coming up and doing their thing, and that's so cute. But what I'm most excited about is all of the youth that are involved. This stage is filled with them singing and sharing the story of Jesus' birth. So we hope you'll come out tonight and support them and encourage their good work in being prepared for this event. We also have our family movie night on December 22nd. Listen, if you've never been here to see the marshmallow spread that Heather puts out for the hot chocolate bar, that alone is worth coming out for. She finds flavors I didn't even know they made. But there will be pizza and popcorn and hot chocolate, and I don't think we've announced the movie yet, so you're going to have to come and find out which movie we've chosen. On January 1st, Sunday, January 1st at 10 a.m., the United Men's Methodist Men's Group is going to be serving at Christ's Table, and we encourage all the men of our church to come out, bring your friends. It's a great opportunity to give back to our community. The United Methodist Men are also having a breakfast here January 2nd at 7 p.m. Everyone's encouraged to come and partake in that and then stick around for church. And then on January 8th at TJ's Restaurant, this is a big event for all the men in the community. They come from just about every church you can name through Brothers in Christ, and it's a wonderful opportunity for the men of our community to come together and fellowship and learn more about Jesus. I'm super excited about this Bible study we have coming up on January 9th. It's going to be Sundays at 11 a.m. in the Embers Room. This is a great study if you have never done a Bible study before, or if you have done a million Bible studies. It is an opportunity for you to see how God's Word proves all that God has promised us. It is a simple a study that you're going to do right in class together, answering questions together. There's not going to be a big commitment of homework after class. We want you to come and enjoy your time learning with other people together in this amazing study. It's going to be led by Todd Sands and Janie Moore, and I know Janie said she'd be hanging out in the lobby if anybody wants to talk to her more about the study, but I encourage you to take part in this opportunity. This is a wonderful way to learn more about how much God loves us and loves the people we meet every day. And also very exciting, January is going to be so much fun, you guys. The Daniel fast is coming. And I know normally that's like a, fast, that's a really bad word. But for us, for our family, we look forward to this all year long. This is an opportunity to either full force, gung-ho, follow the same diet that Daniel followed as he was proving God's greatness. Or you can do a modified version that fits your life and your needs best. But the point is to take these 21 days of prayer and your form of fasting to grow closer to God and see the great miracles God can do in your life. There will be more details coming about that, but you can scan your QR code now for more information as well. And finally, if you have questions about anything that you saw today, do you mind going back to the slide with the phone number, Michelle? Because we all know I can't remember numbers. So if you have any questions about anything we talked about today, you can scan the QR code. You can text 740-265-3855. You can get on our Facebook page or website, call the office, ask somebody you saw up on stage today. Don't leave here with your questions. Have a Merry Christmas, and we'll see you on Christmas Eve.
Well, thanks, Erin. I have the privilege and opportunity to share with you all of the wonderful missional initiatives that are happening in the life of our church and outside of our church. This morning, we had a chance to have Sharon Graves back in our congregation. She just flew in from her missionary work in Europe and the ministry in Spain. And so she's back in town through the end of January, and she's blessed to be here. I also want to make you aware of the fact that this is the fourth Sunday of Advent, so that means a lot of things. But for Rolling Plains Church, it means the opportunity for us to be able to gather God's miracle offering that we've been talking about for four-plus Sundays for Advent Conspiracy. And so for four-plus Sundays, we've been talking about the idea of taking Christmas and turning it upside down. Now, what that means is, in a fancy way, a more simple way, it just means spending less on ourselves than Uncle Ted and the 25th Christmas tie that he doesn't need, or that fruitcake, or whatever it may be that we're purchasing, or the toy without batteries that's just going to upset the child anyways, and so we're spending less on things that we don't really need, and so we can give to people the gift of life who are really in need. And friends, there's three projects that we're sponsoring across the globe, and one of them is a mission and ministry to the people of Haiti that are living in the Dominican Republic. It's a ministry of hope. For them and to meet their needs through schools, through clean water, through all kinds of blessed opportunities. And you can give towards that ministry initiative to the Ministry of Hope there in the Dominican Republic towards the Haitian folk. And praise be to God. I don't know if you've heard the news, but all of those that were being held hostage have been returned safely home. So praise be to God. Let's give him glory. Thank you, Lord. I mean, God is so good. And God is so good, and I imagine there are stories to be told, but we understand that all are healthy and well. We give glory to God. So friends, we have had a heart for Haiti for years at Rolling Plains Church, and that continues with that ministry opportunity. Another one is through Compassion International. We also have partnered with Compassion International on numerous projects. Now, this one specifically revolves around purchasing Christmas gifts to be determined for the needs of the child in whatever context or country they live in across the globe. And you can do that. I know our children's ministry has been participating heavily in that. And so you can give to Compassion International to provide Christmas gifts around the globe. And then also the last one is near and dear to a lot of our hearts in the United Methodist Church. It's called Wings of the Morning Ministry. I have a personal encounter and experience with this. You see, Wings of the Morning Ministry is a medical mission by plane in the Dominican Republic of the Congo. And they provide the ability for medical support for families who are in desperate need of it and can't provide it on their own. In other words, they're flying into places in the bush where people who have an emergency cannot make it to the hospital that they need to make it to. It's literally a life and death situation. And Gaston Ntumbo and his family have this ministry there that we have been of support of in the West Ohio Conference of the United Methodist Church for more than a decade. We personally, as a family, had the opportunity of hosting Gaston Entombo and a friend of his in our home for a weekend because he came and spoke at Rolling Plains several years ago. Friends, that ministry continues yet today. And that's the third project that we give a chance to give to. Now, I want to encourage you that whatever you give towards will go towards that project. If you desire to give towards Wings of the Morning Ministry, when you give that or write that check or that, there's envelopes out there that you can grab on the information desk and you can check mark off or just write down specifically the project you want to give to. Or you can just give to the name of Advent Conspiracy and we'll divide it up and give to the ministry as needed. Friends, today is that day where we collect God's miracle offering. Now, if you say, oh my goodness, I forgot it was today, I'm not prepared, that's okay. We're going to take up another miracle offering on Christmas Eve. But on Christmas Eve, we get a chance to announce the working total that God has given us of what we've collected beginning today. So friends, God is good. As you know, we have unique ways of giving here. And it happens on your way out. You can put it in the boxes on the way out. You can give electronically. You can mail it in, bring it in, or you can bring it with you on Christmas Eve. And we're going to see what God does as God calls us to be his people, his generous people. And as a reminder, everything we give to Advent Conspiracy, none of that comes to our church. None of that is for operating expenses. It just goes strictly to those that are desperately in need. Now, that being said, we have those that are desperately in need here stateside as well. Many of you are familiar with the tornadoes that ravaged much of our country last weekend, particularly hitting places in Kentucky and utterly devastating towns like Mayfield, Kentucky. I don't know if you've seen the pictures, Bowling Green, Kentucky. These are some of the places where Aaron and I cut our teeth on early in our life. We lived in Louisville for a while, and Louisville is just about an hour north of those places. If you've ever been to Umcore Sager Brown mission trip, and we drive down that corridor and go through those areas, you know, many, many lives lost, utter devastation. And some of you are wondering, how do we respond to something like that? I want to encourage you that anytime there's a natural disaster, both nationally and internationally, the United Methodist Church is prepared to respond through a missional initiative called UMCOR. It stands for United Methodist Committee on Relief. And so if you'll check out our Facebook page, you might have to scroll down a little bit, and also go to our website. You'll see some information about our bishop's call to help and support those that are struggling due to the tornadoes through UMCOR, the United Methodist Committee on Relief. Every dollar that you give to what they call the advance, there's an advance number assigned to national and international crises. If you so desire, 100% of your giving goes towards the needs of the people on the ground. None of that goes towards administrative costs. That's one way. The other way we know automatically is to be in prayer. But some of you might feel led to go and do something. And so we have ERTs, emergency response team members, and some of our people in our church have been trained to do so. One of such person is Nora Holtzclaw. Now, Nora and Dean attended at the 8:15 this morning and aren't here at the 10, but she would love to talk to you about what it means to be a part of the ERT or emergency response team. Some of you others have also received that training, and typically those are the people they call on first. We can't send teams of people down there within a week or two of a disaster because they're just not organized to receive us, and it creates more pain and chaos than it does help. But in the coming weeks and months, please know that our missional initiatives team, along with Lori and Nora, are going to keep our ears to the ground and our eyes open to how we can respond. So know that in the past, when we've collected school kits, when we've done health kits, when we've done hygiene kits, when we've done recovery buckets, we might call them flood buckets, those 5-gallon pails that we filled before as a church and we put all kinds of cleaning supplies in there, all of those things go towards UMCOR depots like Sager Brown in Baldwin, Louisiana, and are distributed to these natural disasters. So we may be doing something like that or any of those things in the coming weeks or coming months. Just keep your eyes and ears open for that. And some of that restocks those emergency supplies that exist today because we gave last year to meet the needs of today. So who knows how God is going to guide us and lead us, but we know that your hearts are open to God using you to be a blessing to others. And that's just a message that we wanted to remind you of as our missional initiatives team. So if you have any questions, you want to participate, be in any of those things, if you have some ideas of the way we could participate and respond, please make sure you let us know through your connection card, through the QR code in the app, or come talk to me, Lori, Nora, or anybody else in the missional initiatives team. Now, that being said, by the way, that didn't count in on my time for the sermon, those of you that are checking. It's all right. Bob Evans, they'll still be receiving you after the sermon here today in the service. It'll be okay. But we are living in this series called What Makes a Merry Christmas? And I'm here to ask you a question. How many of you would say that you are ready, Now, you got to be honest, all right? I'm going to ask you to raise your hand, all right? Because your family members are going to know. How many do you, of you truly feel ready for Christmas Eve and Christmas? Raise your hands. Like you're ready. Everything's done. You feel like you're ready. Now, look around the room. There are some hands up, but there are a lot of hands that are like, Pastor John, I still got some shopping to do. I still got to get this taken care of. We still got to figure out how the family's going to get from here to there. Some of you are having like 3 or 4 Christmases on Christmas Day, visiting family and friends, and you're still trying to figure out how all that's going to work and who's going to be where, when, what you're going to do with the pets, those kinds of things. There is a lot of preparation that goes into Christmas, and it started weeks ago, maybe for some of you months ago, with hanging lights and decorating the house and putting up the Christmas tree and buying these gifts or those gifts and getting the cards out and prepping for the parties and the food purchases that are necessary, getting all of the family on the same page, the gifts wrapped and nicely nestled under the tree, trying to figure out how to get the Turbo Man doll in time before anybody else snatches them all up, and to do all this preparation and planning for a Merry Christmas. And the most important thing of all is to make sure that you buy that Lexus and get that big red bow that goes on the top of it so you can surprise your loved one with a payment book for the next 7 years and say, Merry Christmas, dear. Merry Christmas. There's all kinds of strange ways that culture and society prepares for a very Merry Christmas, for the coming together of family and friends. And the question in all of this preparation that we want to ask today and answer a bit is, in all of this preparation for Christmas, have we prepared ourselves for the coming of Christ? Have we prepared ourselves for the coming of Christ? In other words, have we prepared our hearts for the presence of the Lord? Have we prepared our minds and our hearts and our souls to receive the reality of the coming of the Messiah, the Son of God, born unto us? And the question is, what kind of preparation work are we doing to open our heart to God in order to anticipate God doing something brand new in each and every one of us as we approach Jesus' birthday? And if you're struggling with what to buy Johnny or Timmy or Mary or Jane or whatever it might be, and you feel like you don't have enough under the tree for them, the good news is it's not their birthday anyways. It's Jesus' birthday, so don't be worried about that. Now, some of you are actually born on December 25th, so that only works so far. But this is an opportunity to say happy birthday to Jesus, and that's what matters the most. You see, God prepared the way for the coming of his Son, Jesus Christ. And so as we prepare ourselves for Christmas, the question today is, are we allowing God to prepare our hearts and our souls? It's God's desire for us to be prepared for the coming of his Son, just as God prepared for the coming of his Son. And while all the festivities that we've mentioned are a part of that preparation, we can often lose the focus and the point of Christmas in the midst of all of the hustle and the bustle and the pursuit and the planning and the parties and the presents and the punch and the lights and all of those things. Because remember, there was an entire city of Bethlehem, an entire town that was not ready for the coming of the Savior. As a matter of fact, there was no room in the inn for him, and so he was required to be born in a back alley stable because, well, there was not enough room for that miracle birth. And the question for us is there room in our heart this Christmas for the presence of God in Jesus Christ? You see, we can do all of these things and still miss out on a very Merry Christmas, especially when things don't go according to plan. And at some point in time this week, something is not going to go according to plan. You may not be able to find that gift that you're searching for that special someone. You may have your favorite beverage or food item not available on the shelves because of the supply chain issues. You know, right now for us, we're having a hard time finding our favorite chai tea mix. Now, I'm here to tell you, I'm still standing on 2 feet on this platform. Life has not died as we've known it because of that. And it's going to be okay. God is going to be there. He's going to guide us and lead us. And we're still going to have a very Merry Christmas, the most wonderful time of the year, as we recognize Advent as the 4 Sundays that prepares us and leads us up to Christmas Day. Now, what's always interesting about Advent is that we are celebrating the anticipation of Christ coming in his birth as we celebrate his birthday. But interestingly enough, we know that Jesus is already here. I mean, Jesus has already been born. It happened more than 2,000 years ago as we study God's word in the Gospels of Jesus Christ. And so it both prepares us for the coming of Christ in the Messiah, but the intention of Advent is to also prepare us for the second coming of Jesus Christ. In other words, we practice the prep work of Christ coming so that we can be ready for when Christ comes the second time. In Matthew 24, verse 44, this is extra for today, it says, so you must be ready because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. So we live with the anticipation of Christmas as we practice the presence of God, and our preparation work knowing that Christ is coming again soon. And that's the greeting of Maranatha. Though he's already here in the presence of his Spirit, we still celebrate the anticipation of his coming and the prep that comes with it, because we can easily get caught up in the routine of life. And even faith can become routine. And when faith becomes nothing other than a routine, then it's called a religion. And a religion is just practices that may not have the presence and the power thereof of God. They're just simply hollow practices. And so this preparation work allows us to not forget how powerful and special the presence of God is. Or maybe for some of us, the fire of the Holy Spirit in us is flickering a little bit lower than it once was. And we can take God for granted. I mean, how amazing is God's grace and his wonderful presence and his strong power? He's always been there. And the Old Testament story of Israel and the anticipation that they had of the coming of the Messiah and all of the ancient prophecies from Genesis all the way through Zechariah and all of those prophets and books of prophecy and the promises of God's provision to come and to save men and women from their sins, to save all of creation from our brokenness, they were ready, friends. They were hungry. They were hungry for the promises of God. They were desperate for the coming of Christ. It was such good news. There was such great joy when he came. And Christmas is our opportunity to experience the same. You ever hear an incredible message so often that it just becomes secondhand to you and it kind of loses its luster? You ever watch your favorite movie so much that eventually you get to the point where it doesn't have the same effect that it did to you the very first time that you watched it? I used to have the reputation in my own life of when a great song came out, I would burn out on it in about 10 minutes because I would just play it over and over and over again. It was so awesome. And by 10 minutes later, it wasn't that awesome anymore. It didn't sound fresh and new. And friends, the season of Christmas that we celebrate every calendar year in God's church exists so that the good news of Jesus Christ is fresh and new, almost like the very first time we ever heard it. And that's why it's called the good news of great joy. Here's a such prophecy that we've been alluding to in the book of Micah in the Old Testament. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come from me one who will rule over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient of times. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth, and he will be our peace. Who are they prophesying about? They're prophesying about the Messiah, about Jesus himself. And friends, when I hear things like this, I don't know about you, but my heart shouts, I'm ready, Lord. I need you, Jesus. I need that wonderful counselor. I need that mighty God. I need the everlasting Father. I need the Prince of Peace that was prophesied in the book of Isaiah. I need that in my life. I'm hungry. I'm desperate for more. More of you. As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth for you, the psalmist would write. I'm ready, Jesus. Come on, God, bring him. In all of our preparation, we find ourselves before the humble means of God delivering a Savior into our life, Christ Jesus, our Lord, his Son, his only Son, given to us as a sacrifice for our sin. And he wasn't born into any kind of royalty or a palace. He was born in a stall in the back alley where animals feed from. That's what a manger is. A manger is a feeding trough for animals. And that's where he lay. We're reminded of humble beginnings. And it's the humble beginning in our heart that creates space for God to work. We're reminded that he wasn't born in a large city in the hustle and bustle. We know that there was no room in the inn or where all the limelight was happening, but that he was to be ushered off into the quiet of the night, under the quiet radar of a small town, to a simple man and woman, a man whose trade was just a simple carpenter. While not born into royalty, he was in the lineage of royalty of the line of King David. It's interesting that light that not only were there not any kind of royalty there, there were no biblical scholars there. The Sadducees, the Pharisees, all of these religious scholars, none of them were there. It was just simply a small band of third shift workers from the fields. We know that shepherds were the only audience. You see, Israel, they were ready. Their appetites were hungry. They were waiting. They were thirsty for the coming of the Messiah. They were ripe in need for a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And Christmas is our opportunity to get hungry again, to get amazed again at how good our God is, and to let his perfect presence and perfect plan for us fill us with such a great joy. It's like the first time for the good news. I think there's a song out there. Feels like the first time. I mean, that's what Christmas is. It's an opportunity for us to experience the good news like it's experienced for the first time, that the Christ child has been given to us. He's our salvation, and we have abundance on earth and eternity waiting for us in heaven as a result of his presence, and we're preparing for the presence of God. And friends, that makes for a very merry Christmas. You see, God sent a herald in front of Jesus to prepare the way, and his name is John. John the Baptist, God sent John to prepare the way. An angel of the Lord, you know the story, we talked about it last week, appeared to Zechariah and shared the good news of a son that was going to be born to him and to Elizabeth. Now, Zechariah's mind was blown because, well, they couldn't have children. They were barren in their years, and yet God was delivering a miracle blessing to them that this was going to be no ordinary child, but God had a plan for his son to prepare the way for God's own son. In Luke chapter 1, verse 17, we see that account. And he will go on before the Lord, the Bible says, in the spirit and the power of Elijah, another incredible prophet of the Lord, to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And so God sent John the Baptist, to prepare the hearts of God's creation to be ready for the coming of his son, Jesus Christ, the Lord their God. And I love this. John leaps in the womb of Elizabeth, his mother. You remember that? We talked about that last week. See, Mary's been given the news. She's to give birth to a child who's going to be Christ the Lord. He's going to be the Savior of the world. She's a virgin, and yet she's going to be with child. And she's blown away by this news. And one of the things that God comforts her with is the news that, well, one of her relatives is with child as well, and I'm going to use him as a tool to introduce the world to my son that's coming. And so Mary shows up at Elizabeth's house. Elizabeth's pregnant, and Mary's pregnant. And what happens when Mary shows up? What happens in Elizabeth's womb? What does John the Baptist do? By the way, fully human and still in the womb, the first person to ever worship the Savior Jesus Christ was a fetus. Think about that for a second. And what does he do in the womb? He jumps. It's like, listen, this I got to get out of here. This news is so good. I'm ready. I'm ready to be God's herald. I'm ready for this message of the Messiah that I get a chance to preach. He knew his purpose, and he was ready to get to work. The Bible says that he leaped in Elizabeth's womb at the presence of the Savior. And if God sent John the Baptist to prepare his creation for the work of Jesus, then we want to lean in this Christmas time in the preparation work of the coming of Christ and his virgin birth. In Luke chapter 3, verses 3 to 6, the Bible goes on about John the Baptist. It says he went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it was written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare ye the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. And every valley shall be filled, every mountain and hill made low. The crooked road shall become straight, the rough way smooth, and all people will see God's salvation. And so through this, God gives us the inclination of the work of John the Baptist that existed in order to prepare the hearts of the people. And this is the preparation work. This is the preparation work that he gives us, that God calls us to repentance, to receive the gift of Christ. Remember, he was preaching a baptism, the Bible says, of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, that his sacrificial grace would wash away all of our sin. So friends, here's the key to a very Merry Christmas this year. A repentant heart prepares us for Christmas. If we're going to prepare for Christmas, yes, we're going to hang lights, we're going to wrap packages and presents, but if our soul is going to be prepared to receive the Christ child, then we have to have a repentant heart that prepares us for Christmas. To receive what God wants to give us, we approach the birth of Christ and his birthday with a repentant and humble heart. A humble heart, just like the humble beginnings of Jesus in that stable. We are aware of our human condition. We become aware all over again of our fleshly nature, and we confess that we have not followed God's teachings. We confess that we have broken his commands. I'm looking at a crowd of people here today that have broken God's commands, and you're looking at a man standing on a platform that has broken God's commands. And those of you that are listening on the internet or watching, you have broken God's commands. All of us are guilty of not following in the full glory of Christ. The Bible says that all have fallen short of the glory of God, and all of us are in need of forgiveness. And so as a result of that, let's just not gloss over it. Let's not think we're just a bunch of good people and that God is blessing us because we're good people. No, we are a bunch of broken people, and God is sacrificing his son so that we might be saved from our sin. And when we realize that, we become humble. And we realize that the Bible says that none are good except one. And God is good. Now, I'm not saying that means we live in shame. That does not exist to attack our self-esteem. It doesn't mean we fall to the ground and allow people to walk over us and Satan to walk over us. It doesn't mean we're no good. None of that is true. But what is true is we are in desperate need of a Savior, and God has the power to save us, and He gave us His Son to do so. And when we open our hearts to that reality, as we approach Christmas, we can have a very Merry Christmas, regardless of what's stocked on the shelves or not stocked on the shelves, regardless of what's under the tree or not under the tree. A repentant heart is what prepares us for Christmas. You know, we've ignored God's promptings. We've slandered others. We've not been available when God's called us. We've had hang-ups and habits in our life that don't honor God. We've done our own thing, and God just simply wants us to repent and to open our hearts and to humble ourselves. I remember as a kid when I would goof up or mess up, or I didn't study for something that I should have studied, or if I told a lie when I was supposed to be telling the truth, or I didn't do something that I was told to do, that I would receive some kind of discipline. And oftentimes it required for me to apologize. Now, my parents were able to sniff out something when it came to apologizing, because typically I would just say, well, I'm sorry. Now, typically what that meant as a kid is I was sorry for getting caught. I wasn't necessarily sorry for what I did. Am I talking to some of the right people here today? Remember when we were kids? Some of you young people that are out there right now, you're a young person, you understand exactly what I'm saying. Some of us as parents right now, we understand exactly what that means. And what I notice about my folks in those moments is that they would allow me to languish a little bit in my discipline or whatever punishment it was until I was truly sorry. Now, parents just have this ability to know when their child is truly being repentant, right? Amen? This is like a sixth sense that God gives us. And so oftentimes we'll allow our child to languish in that discipline until their heart is ready to be changed, and also their heart is ready to truly be repentant, until I would come to my mom and my dad and I say, you don't want to know what? Mom and Dad, I truly am sorry. I know that telling the truth is so important, and I really blew it with you guys. I'm so sorry. Would you please forgive me? And my parents are like, you don't want to know? Every single moment that ever happened, my life was met with one thing, and that was grace. God's amazing grace showed up through my parents when I would open my heart to them and truly be repentant. That grace and mercy was always there. And friends, that translates into our relationship with God. If we would just simply humble ourselves and come before our God and not put on this persona like we're perfect, you know, like we got it all going on, like we're really we are a good person. Friends, in the power of the Lord Jesus Christ, God is good. And because of His presence in our life, we are made great because of who God is. And that requires us to humble ourselves and to confess our sins before our God. And God will wait for us to do that before we are able to access His amazing grace. His amazing grace is in your life, but we can't taste it until we truly repent and come before Him. In the Bible, in Psalms, it says, "You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, that You, God, will not despise." In other words, in the Old Testament law, they were required to bring animals to be sacrificed for the breaking of God's law, and it was the blood of that animal sacrifice that was necessary to be made right with God. The Bible says that blood is always necessary for God's forgiveness. Now, the psalmist here is basically sharing with us that it has been God's desire all along that we would approach Him with a heart that is truly broken because of our sin as our sacrifice, and not some physical animal as our sacrifice. That He requires and desires just simply a humble heart that cries out, "I'm sorry, I need You in my heart, forgive me, God." And so rather than condemn us in that moment, God forgives us with the coming of Christ, ushering in His new covenant and new promise that no longer requires the sacrifice of animals, but only a single sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross and a repentant heart on our part. In Hebrews, the Bible follows up with that and says in the New Testament, "First, Christ said, You did not want animal sacrifices or sin offerings or burnt offerings or other offerings for sin, nor were You pleased with them, though they are required by the law of Moses. Then He said, 'Look, I have come to do Your will.' He cancels the first covenant in order to put the second into effect. For God's will was for us to be made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all time." And so what we realize is that Christmas is a reminder that there are no more sacrifices needed. There are no more burnt offerings. There are no more fleshly sacrifices that are needed, but that Jesus is the one sacrifice for all time for the forgiveness of our sin. And the only sacrifice that God is calling us to make is a sacrifice of a broken heart and a contrite spirit that comes and says, "Forgive me, Lord. I need Your Son. I need Your way of salvation." So we prepare the way for a Merry Christmas with a repentant heart and a broken spirit. We fall to our knees on this O holy night that Christ is born, overwhelmed by God's loving pursuit and provision of us in the person and work of his Son, Jesus Christ, that through him we can be set free and see that we are freed from the law of sin and of death. And friends, the only response that we can have in that moment, if we truly understand what God has done for us, is to be humbled. It humbles us, doesn't it? It humbles us to say, God, I'm sorry you've not been first place in my life. I'm sorry, I want more of you and less of me. God, I'm sorry, I want less sin in my life and I want more of your holiness. I want to pursue your holiness in my life and all that I do. And as you gave me your Son, Jesus Christ, I want to give my entire life to you. And so we prepare our hearts to receive this gift. We take off the wrapping paper and we take in the presence of Jesus Christ and the Spirit of the Lord, and we have a very Merry Christmas as a result of it. You see, friends, at the end of the day, a repentant heart is prepared to receive the gift of God's Spirit in us. Our repentant heart makes our lives available for the Spirit of the Lord to do a new work in us. It creates an opening. It creates a dwelling place for the Spirit of God to reside in us and fill in us and to do a new work, a fresh life in us. If we want a fresh start, if we want a new work to happen in our life, it starts with the presence of God in us to truly change us and transform us from this life of sin into a life that honors God. In Matthew, the Bible says in chapter 3, verse 11, I baptize you with water for repentance. This is John the Baptist speaking now as probably a 30-some-year-old adult. But after me comes one who is more powerful than I. I love this. Whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. He's speaking of Jesus. Now, I can often remember when I said I was sorry to my parents. I know now as a parent what their ultimate hopes were is two things. Number one, that I would repent from what I had done and that I wouldn't do that again. And then secondly, that that would be a learning experience that would transform and change my life. That as a result of the discipline, the corrective behavior, that my life would change as a result of that. Friends, that is the purpose and the call of God in our life. And the placement of his Holy Spirit in our hearts that comes with the presence of Jesus is that not only would we repent of our sin because we're sorry, but that we would no longer do it again and invite the Holy Spirit to fill us with his incredible power and holiness and presence, but that God would allow that we would allow God to change and transform our life and truly be different as a result of his response of amazing grace that we don't deserve. And we're like, oh my goodness, God, thank you. And because of this, I want to live differently for you. A prepared and repentant heart is open to giving access to Jesus and the Spirit of the Lord to fill every part of our life, to carry in us the power of canceled sin. And so we're going to allow Advent to prepare the way for our heart, to be open to the work of God in us, to say, God, I'm broken. I've messed up. I need you. Thank you, God, for your Son. I receive him. I'm ready for you to do something new in me. And because I've learned to be ready for Jesus, the Messiah, come his birthday, I'm also prepared and ready for him to return again, and I'm going to live a Maranatha life. I'm going to be ready because someday soon, Christ is going to come back. And he's not going to come in the form of a manger. He's going to come in the form of all of his glory, friends. And we're going to get a chance to be swept up with him for those who believe. And I want to be ready for that day. And I know you do too. So we're going to approach Christmas with a heart that is prepared in this manner, because there's no telling the work of blessing that is going to come our way when we live prepared for God. But we know one thing that is for sure that is in store for us this Christmas is that in Jesus Christ and nothing else, we know we will experience an abundance of blessing. That no matter what goes on in our life, no matter what bad memory we associate in our mind with Christmas, no matter who we've lost in the last year, no matter what broken moment we're living in right now, no matter whatever lack we have, no matter whatever mental state that we're in, no matter what's going on in our heart, that if we'll lean into the person and work of Jesus Christ, born unto us and coming back again soon, then we can and will have a very Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas, friends. Merry Christmas. Let me share a couple of action steps with you. I want to invite our worship team to come back up front and we'll be done. First action step is to come to the altar and fall to your knees. Friends, this altar is open just like it is every worship celebration that we have here. Our prayer ministry team is going to be here and available to pray with you. And friends, some of us, we just need to fall to our knees. We need the action of putting one foot in front of the other and making a move towards God. You might have a tremendous need in your life, a health issue, a loved one who's on a deathbed or a crisis that you have no control and power over. The good news is God does. And so come to him in prayer. You may desire to join God's church. You may be seeking baptism for the very first time. You may have a life change. Then come forward and let's talk about that. And let's pray over one another. You just may need to be in the presence of God. And for you, that means just making a move towards the cross, towards the platform, towards the stage, and to stand here and just stand in awe of God. Whatever that means for you, friends, come to the altar and fall to your knees as we hear in the song, O Holy Night. Secondly, invite the Holy Spirit to dwell in your heart. Invite the Holy Spirit to dwell in your heart. And thirdly, receive the gift of God's grace and open up the presence of God so that you can experience his gift and his presence of Jesus in our life. Would you pray with me, friends? Lord God, we give you all the glory. We thank you for this day. And Lord God, we pray for all those that are struggling and suffering as a result of natural disasters around this world, but specifically our hearts are geared towards those in our nation, specifically in Kentucky and other states. Would you be a blessing to them, Lord God, and use their stories to build their testimony of your wonderful presence and power of provision. Lord God, we pray that you would continue to do an amazing work in each and every one of us as we dash around this week, as we hustle and bustle to prepare whatever it is our image of an incredible Christmas will look like. And in the midst of it, Lord God, would you help us not miss the miracle in the middle of the noise? Lord God, would you allow us to have our hearts prepared? God, here today, we pray that you would humble us. We pray that you would remind us of the nature of our sin, the nature of our flesh and our human condition that cost you everything. But you were blessed to be able to do so because of your great love for us. And Lord God, let us be humbled all over again by your amazing love and your amazing grace for us that not only forgives us of sin, but can change and transform our entire life. Lord God, would you prepare our hearts? Would you prepare our hearts as we walk towards this Christmas celebration this week and be mindful of all that it means, of what it meant when you came and what it means when you're going to come again. And it's in all this we say, God, thank you for preparing our hearts and preparing the way of your Son, Jesus. We say thank you that we get a chance to have an incredible Christmas no matter what our circumstances look like, no matter what's going on in our life, because we have your Son, Jesus. And it's in his great name we pray and give thanks. And everybody said together, amen and amen. Friends, I want to share a very special prayer with you. It's called the Lord's Prayer, and I just want to do that with you right now. And I think that Michelle always does a great job, and she'll probably have that up on the screen here in just a few moments. But let's share that right now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Well, friends, now is our opportunity for God's miracle offering. If you, in your mind, have brought something for Advent Conspiracy, or you brought your weekly tithe that God calls us to give to God's church, then know that as we stand, there are boxes behind us on your way out that you can drop those gifts in. You can do it online, and or you can bring in your giving to the church. As we trust God for his miracle work in our life, let's stand and sing this closing song.
Love incarnate, love divine, star and angels gave the sign. Bow to babe on bended knee, the savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, he shall reign forevermore. Glory.
The question is, are we ready? Are we ready to receive what God has already done? The cross is for you. The manger under the cross is for you. It's a reminder that the work has already been done, that all that is needed for preparation for a very Merry Christmas is an open heart, a broken heart, and a contrite spirit that says, God, I need you. And when we do that, it's an invitation for God to have His way in our life. And if we're willing to open ourselves to that, God will never let us down. Our God does not have supply chain issues. He has already delivered the presence of His Son, Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit that you have access to at every given moment of your life. And so as you go, allow God to prepare your heart for the miracle blessing that is to come, and to live according to His promises because of it. And I pray that you have a very Merry Christmas as we look forward to seeing you tonight at our children's play at 6 or for Christmas Eve services on December 24th. Friends, Merry Christmas, everybody.
No way.